Thanks everyone. My name is Naveen Mohda. My family came to Bangalore in 85, so for all practical purposes I'm a Bangalorean. I don't remember too many movies I watched in 2019, so if I were to pick, it's a movie called Evarum, a Telugu movie. Okay, let's get started. So this is what you can expect from this talk. People who are on the right door are in the wrong talk. So, I have about 2 decades of experience. The last few companies I've worked for have been in the space of consumer internet. And my observations are largely based upon these companies. Can people see this? It's a formula for calculating the displacement of an object in motion. Now, can somebody tell me if the formula is right? Yes. One single derivation. Now, there are 2 parts to this. One is the math and one is the science.
So, the second one doesn't give you the distance covered, right?
No, I'm replacing B with the formula. Okay. The takeaway from this is that you can prove that the math is right, you cannot prove that the formula is right. So it may have wind drag, it may have friction, it may have other variables. Why did we settle for this in high school?
Simplify things.
Another thing is that the quality of measurements determine the quality of your hypothesis. Takeaway is that science is empirical. Math is deductive. And software development is a science, and we are largely doing it by empirical methods. So I'm proposing some ideas which I believe can make a difference to the quality of software development. So we being technologists, let's start with some definitions. I'll start with the definition of dual. It has 2 definitions which are of interest to me. The first definition is, it consists of 2 parts, basically pair of anything. And the second definition is that an object is a construct is a dual of another. If you interchange some parts of it, you get the other. A simple example is, x and minus x are duals. Straightforward. Things become a little more interesting when you move to 2-dimensional space. The coordinate x, y has a dual minus x, y if you change the polarity of one of the coordinates. Similarly, x, minus y is also a dual of x, y. And similarly, minus x minus y is also a dual of x, y. We have 3 different duals based upon 3 different transformations. How many of you have read the book 7 Habits of Highly Effective Individuals? You might remember this. Stephen Covey talks about the difference between a characteristic and personality ethic. A characteristic is somebody who goes on looks, social behavior, influencing, and as a personalizer. The character is the one who relies on integrity, honesty, humility, collaboration, and so on. If you draw a parallel to software development, yes. So there are 2 ways of accomplishing software development. One is effort, other is knowledge. I believe we are a largely an effort slides, I have underlined what I think are the areas of improvement in contemporary software development. So this talk focuses on the knowledge aspect. How many of you can read this? Please raise your hand. How many of you know what it means? I didn't ask you, but so for folks who couldn't read it, how long do you think you'll take to understand this phrase? Assuming that you had no internet, or you had internet, but you can't talk to some person who knows about it.
30 seconds. 30 seconds.
Without knowing the Kannada grammar, the
we have internet, right? So
no, even for that, Google has to lead to OCR and maybe some of those capabilities.
As long as Google understands the speed.
Yes. So imagine if there was a world without Google. Trying to understand this would take you years of preparation, reading all the grammar, the alphabet, the sandhis, and all of those things. So this, there are two kinds of, the two mechanisms of acquiring knowledge. On-demand learning and learning a priori. Trying to read a two-word phrase itself would have been almost impossible with on-demand learning. So there are places where on-demand learning is useful and the scenarios where learning a priori is useful. I believe this aspect of learning is underutilized in our domain. Okay, there are three different requirements. How do you start an array where each element is 0 or a 1? How about the next one? Where each element is between in the interval 0 and k.
By traversing the array, keep putting them into each one.
Do you think the first and second requirements are same or different?
Yeah, fundamentally yes.
First is subset.
No, okay. My mental model is that there are two different requirements. They're similar, they're not the same. The specification for the first program is different from the second, is different from the third. Now, I wanted to introduce to you this dual of S program and E program. This is a nomenclature from a paper in the 1970s. The author categorizes program into three buckets. Two of the buckets are of interest to me. A S program is a program which has a clear and precise specification, like the zeros and ones and 0 to k. Now, a program like shopping cart for Flipkart, ride share from Uber, the requirements are continuously changing. Other system is a E program. A lot of what we have read in school allow us to excel in the S program bucket. But our day job is largely in the E program bucket. My hypothesis is that things like complexity theory, predictive models, operating systems, network theory, we have been groomed for the S program bucket and not enough for the E program bucket. Okay. So there are two different poses. I will not attempt you to do it, but most people will not have a trouble doing this pose. They have trouble understanding the pose. But once they understand the pose, they're able to accomplish this. While here, almost everybody understands what they need to do in a short duration of time. and very rarely they are able to perform this pose. The pose on the right was simple. The pose on the left is easy. Simple is something you can derive, it's an object, it's an objective measure, while easy is a subjective measure. Over time, this might become easy. So here's my first recommendation. If you have a familiarity with simplicity graph, what the three predominant styles of programming: procedural, object oriented, and functional. People think they know Java, people think they know the code in Java. But I can, from my experience, number of people who actually know and do original programming is minuscule. So in terms of programming model, my first recommendation is functional programming. This is a bias called streetlight bias. So the gentleman is looking for some, I think, quarter. The policeman asks him, what are you looking for? Did you drop it here? He says, no, I drop it elsewhere. The policeman asks him, why are you looking here? He says, because there's light. So here's a quote I got from a book on mathematics. From when Europe got to understand zero to when they adopted it, it was almost 1,000 years. As programmers and as management, we optimize for things which we are familiar and closer to us, not necessarily what is required for the problem. So like the drunkard, the need was to go and search in a different place. What was easy for him was to search in a place which was light, which had light. So the situations where we need to bridge this gap between need and ease. So if we stretch too far from the ease zone, it is, you may enter into a terror zone, and we need to maintain a balance between how much we can stretch ourselves and the engineers and how much we can move towards the need. This is a state diagram for a Hibernate JPA entity manager. Object can be managed, detached, removed, and so on. So, how many of you are familiar with the notion of a repository from the domain-driven design? So, this actually, the moment you add to a repository, it is equivalent to it getting persisted. Once you remove from it, it is equivalent to that no longer being persisted. So this paradigm is actually powerful, sufficient, and complete. And it is easy for developers to comprehend. By coming up with a suitable abstraction, we are bridging the gap between need and ease. So, example is, I had to build an application where we had to work on users and roles. So, these are our repositories which had the paradigm I just spoke about. And there is a workflow manager which has tool methods to perform things atomically. So, this is the work manager. You can think of it as a transaction manager. It has two simple methods. One, which takes a repository and performs the side effect, another which is a repository and returns to you a value of type t. So we could quickly write code like this to perform our business needs. Again, the takeaway from here is this is easy and this is close to our requirements. The craft of software engineering is to make needful things easy to you and your fellow programmers. Forget motivation, you need discipline. You'll find articles like this peddled all over in pop culture. So, between motivation and no discipline, and no motivation and discipline, maybe this is better. But compared to these two, isn't this better? Nobody told you you had to pick only one of these two, but you can have both. This kind of overemphasis on one option given many is a fallacy called focalism. It is ubiquitous, it is peddled and encouraged. When the number of options is 2, focalism becomes binary thinking. It has its dual called the yin-yang. Yin-yang is a Chinese philosophy. It is a concept of dualism. Instead of looking at things as competition, it looks as forces as complementary, interdependent and interconnected. I will talk about interdependent forces of software development for the rest of this talk. How many of you have heard this statement? Perception is reality. Anybody? But it isn't. Another common fallacy is that something which is actually composed of yin and yang, we forget the distinction between yin and yang and think of them as a single concept. So, nobody asked me about my hobbies, so I was a runner. If I were to run too much and not recover enough, my performance would suffer. If I don't run enough but spend a lot of time on recovery, I won't necessarily get better. So this talks about a balance between run and recovery, the yin and yang. Life is full of these examples. If you're driving a car and if you use only the brake, you will go nowhere. If you use only the accelerator, you will get to a place you wish you wouldn't have.
That is also sort of nowhere.
It maybe wasn't nowhere. So this manifests in other domains as well. One is in economics. Economies have phases of expansion and contraction. They don't grow like this. They grow too much, compensate, grow too much, compensate, grow too much, compensate. This is observed in ecology as well. This is a mathematical model between population of prey and predators. As the population of the prey increases, so does the population of predators. As the population of predators increase, the population of prey decreases, and so on. So these are two cyclic graphs. And this I came across recently, Carl Jung, a leading psychiatrist, said that your conscious and unconscious minds should be integrated the moment they're disassociated. You may have physical and mental problems. This is This philosophy is prevalent in Hinduism, Taoism, Buddhism, as well as Western culture. This couplet talks about it beautifully. All work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. All play and no work makes Jack a mere cub. So this is one of my pet arguments, my fellow developers. Theory without practice is empty, and practice without theory is blind. So the very fact that you guys are here, you are listening to the theory, tells you you subscribe to this hypothesis. There are some obvious yin-yangs in software development. How we store data, zeros and ones are yin-yang. If else, free malloc, request response, pub sub, scatter gather, lock and lock. But I'm more interested in the non-trivial things. Who's heard of the Conway's law? Conway's law tells you that the structure of your organization and the structure of your software start mirroring each other. You cannot build powerful software, useful software, unless you have a nimble and loosely coupled organization. Can somebody tell me what this piece of code does? I've tried this example multiple times. I'm yet to have anybody come close. Given an integer I, it finds the number of set bits in that number. This piece of code is correct. It is performant. It is understandable by machines. If there had been a bug or you had to enhance it, I guess most of you will struggle with this. So, a very important dual in programming is the dual of essence and ceremony.
But when you given the bugs, you are giving the given the statement also, what the program has to perform, what the expectation is there. Yeah. But in this is a blind code, like it can do, you cannot define at instant.
For most people who are familiar with programming like Java or C#, who understands every single operator specified here, they will not be able to understand the whole thing. Because it's a highly ceremonious code. We understand each bit, but we can't put them together. There are too many things happening.
Yes.
So, how do you avoid ceremonious code? Human thinking is based upon human cognition, human communication is based upon essence. If I ask you how you go from here to Koramangala, you will not say, get up from your chair, go walk 15 feet, open the door handle here. You are going to give information like, take the water boat, take a right over there. That is essence. Humans think in terms of essence. We communicate with each other via code as well. And that should be essence-driven or intent-revealing code and not ceremonious code. That's the intent of this slide. So, I'm proposing two patterns over here where you can convey the essence of your code cleanly. First is a compose method pattern, other is a functional program. So here is a very ceremonious code, which has 9 lines, and typically you would put comments bracketing them. The essence revealing code basically puts them into 3 high level methods and implementations of this. Anybody who understands this code is more likely to understand the essence of this compared to the ceremonious counterpart. There are additional benefits. The part methods become better tested. You can scrutinize things better. You can understand where the bugs might be. The part methods might be reusable in other contexts. And the part methods typically get closed before the pole. So this is the functional equivalent of it. So this conveys the essence, and people who really want to understand the ceremony can double click, get onto these methods and understand the ceremony part. So going back to the classification earlier, E programs can be built on S programs. These parts of code have clear-cut specification. It's easy to understand them better. It is possible for them to be reused in multiple contexts. I'm an advocate of functional programming. I've written a library at LinkedIn. So this is ceremonious code. This is a lot more closer to how we think about the problem and solution. I'll give a metaphor from the field of automobile manufacturing. The designers of the this field have to optimize for manufacturing. How many cars do they manufacture? What is speed of latency of manufacturing in each car? What is the utilization rate of the workers on the floor? These are some of the things they need to optimize for. You can build a car from Legos, but people typically don't build cars like this. They build a platform which has a lot of things pre-built, and they focus on assembling the chassis, braking systems, fuel tank, and so on. So designers in the automobile industry have to design for manufacturing. They also need to design for assembly. Optimizing only for one but not for the other might be counterproductive in the long term. So if you have a class, creating multiple instances of it is no big deal. If you have a schema, having tens of millions of rows is no big deal, and so on. A lot of the internet space companies seem to be optimized for runtime efficiency and not enough for development time efficiency. Another way of looking at this, they are designed for performance, they are not designed for evolution. And I really want you to ingest this slide. There is a lot more software design than system design. Figuring out your Cassandra, Kafka, MySQL is only a small part of your software development. So modeling, the most common and predominantly used technique for modeling is the box and arrows paradigm. This is useful for small problems, but it does not really scale. So I'll come back to the part. If you look at software as a stack, the bottommost being your infrastructure and the topmost being your business layer, a lot of emphasis seems to be put on the bottom layer, not enough on the top of your stack. Techniques like domain-driven design, business-driven design are not as employed as they should be. Going back to the man-machine, this is a fundamentally different set of characteristics. Machines can think locally, humans think globally. Machines are about detail, humans are about idea. Machines have infinite memory, large memory, humans have limited memory, and so on. We seem to optimize for this aspect of software development and not enough for this. There are two implementations which abstract month. Which of them is better and why?
because it is more descriptive and
it is our language. It's human language.
There is one additional thing which is better in the second case.
It creates a better level of abstraction that we can understand.
It does not let you give legal combinations. Minus 1, 13, there is no notion of addition of 2 months. There is no notion of subtraction of 2 months. While this actually does more than this, this is actually a tighter representation of your concept. So concept is what we think about it, and representation is how we convey to software.
By the sense, by I'm getting by the word essence, what you are meaning is appropriate level of abstraction, right? By the yes. So to create one abstraction that is sufficient, we have to have not if exhaustive, at least sufficient knowledge of the abstraction we are creating, isn't it? So in our domain, it's mostly not the case that we understand, but the abstraction we are creating. So how do you propose that we design the abstraction in such a way that it can evolve
as the requirement evolves?
I'll answer it in a little slide. I have a slide for that. So in my early days of understanding OO programming, this was an advice. Nouns are objects, verbs are methods. Is login an object or a method? Google tells me when the last time I logged in. How can they implement this functionality? It's a, they interpret login as an object. So, the act of verification is a fundamentally powerful and not well understood concept in software. It tells you that when a construct can be treated as a value without restriction, login is a right-fied construct. It is a machine understandable construct. So we do dependency is not a noun, nor is it a verb. But because we represent it as a software understandable construct, we can do things like we have iterative cycles and so on. So to bridge the gap between man, what man men can think, and what machines can compute, it is only possible if we have reified constructs. Here's another example. The two pieces of code. This gives you a list of x coordinates, this gives you y coordinates, and this gives you a list of points. Where a point, each of them has a x and y coordinate. Which of these representations are better and why? Why? Yes. So this actually is more powerful. We can do more. But this is actually less powerful. But this is provides you what's called a first class, that's a first class construct. This is the second class construct. As a programmer, you don't have to be aware of this information and mentally assemble it together while you're working on this piece of code. What is first class in your code? And what is not should be a fundamental activity you should ponder about.
Other difference is this also. Now in the point, if I want to change any attribute, I can add any. But in the first method, I need to keep on changing the method name.
Yes. Point taken. But I want to emphasize on the first class ness of construct. How many of you have encountered situations like this when you work on somebody else's code? I believe there's more people in So, how many of you have been confused by your own code? You'll look at it later. So, if you look at the duals of you and the future you, how do you keep them in sync? By writing intent-revealing code, by writing code which conveys the essence, by rifying the right constructs, by having the right first-class constructs. So, when I'm looking over here, I'm not able to see clearly people on this side. When I'm trying to look at a bigger set of audience, the amount of information which I'm gathering about each of you is actually less. So the way we think is a combination of selection and projection. Selection, you reduce the number of entities. In projection, you reduce an amount of information on the entities you are thinking about. So most of our designs, we seem to do a good job on selecting. We don't seem to do a good enough job on the projection part. So this is a system I built in Yahoo. This is how most of us would have modeled it. There is one microservice, which is a pre-processing microservice. There's another, which is an aggregating service. This actually goes for design in most many cases. What is actual data which flows through each of them? We have projected that information out. In this data flow diagram, I have chosen to keep that information, the list of events. Compared to this from here, I realize that these three are actually doing something similar. Now, because of this similarity, I know that these three constructs can have a base class. And similarly, the filter knows dedupe, the dedupe knows count. How many of you use microservices? Something like this would be, I expect, to be the predominant model. It's called the choreography model. Each component has a clear idea of what it needs to do. It knows whom it needs to communicate with. It has a very clear idea what it needs to do. The other model is the orchestration model. The amount of global knowledge each service has is limited, and they rely on external entity to tell them when to act and so on. Between these two models, the orchestration model is a lot less employed than it should be. So the moment I have this, the filter does not necessarily have to talk with dedupe directly. Dedupe does not talk to the count directly. They rely on external entity to tell us when to communicate. So this is a modeling language called SysML. It has a diagram called block diagram. This is an abstraction. This is the client-server, and both of them are talked to the list of events interface I spoke earlier. Now, given this, you can abstract a connector, and you have a connector which communicates between two in-memory components, another which connects between two intra-process components. By doing this, components like dedupe, filter, and count become quite small, narrow focus, and clean. While the heavy lifting of communication, logging, and so on are moved to a different abstraction called client diagram. And you have dual of container and component. So the takeaway from the last few slides is that we used orchestration, we used different projections, we came up with the good ramifications, and I walked you through evolution of from a system to a platform. So the system that was built was stream processing engine, where you had a bunch of slave nodes which could host each of these components. What gets wired to what was information which was sent from a orchestrator, which would tell them, hey, you go to this machine. From A, send it to B, based on definition and so on. This you see, information, once the routes had been set up, data would flow in and flow out. This is the control plane. This is the data plane. This kind of thinking is largely missing in contemporary architecture. Okay, here's from my favorite comic, XKCD. Somebody wants to build a once solid, and the other person is actually building a system which will pass quantum bits in the future. So this kind of over platformization is something which is quite prevalent. On the flip side, Henry Ford said, if I'd ask people what they want, they would have said faster horses. Here, the other person was not listening to requirements and it was not a beneficial interaction. Here, because he chose not to listen to the consumer, he was able to build a good product. There is no universal trade-off. So here's a good metaphor to think about it. Here, you have a traditional water flow kind of a model. You build a tire and something and you eventually have a car. Here, you have a scooter, then you have a cycle, and a motorcycle, and a car. Here, you have a partially functional car and you keep adding more capabilities. In the first scenario, the utility is actually zero till here it shoots up. Here, the utility shoots up but drops again. Shoots up, drops again, and so on. Here, utility shoots up and continues to grow. This is how you keep a synergy between your requirements and your capabilities.
I have a question too. So, it also depends on the consumer where the utility is. So, while this might be oversimplification, there can be use cases where, let's say, the second model makes sense.
Yes.
Right. So,
all models are approximations. Some models are useful. So, the dual of form and function is powerful. We seem to focus a lot on the function and not enough on the form. But this is a realization of the same. You can first build the example of the stream processing system I built. Somebody had built the application, a bunch of refactoring made it into a platform. So by focusing on the form, we were able to build a more powerful system. Given a road with uniform width, uniform elevation, no traffic signals, no traffic, it would be a breeze to drive. And this is what we have the placement agreements. There is no uniformity of any kind. What part of the road should be for what vehicles, how many lanes, no discipline. The third system is the number of vehicles are present, but there is a degree of structure. The width of a road, of a lane is, and so on, is uniform. People follow the discipline. Between this and this, which system allows you to travel faster?
Well, it also depends. See, because there are a lot of resources available here that we can build wider roads. If you go back to the previous scenario, you probably don't have that resource available to you.
Mm-hmm.
So you have the constraint. So, there have been similar strategies in different industries. In airline industry, you might see that when we are boarding, they would let the people who are in the back to board first, board earlier, and they would let the front people board later. However, the studies show that if you let people board at a random order, it's actually faster than
the traditional
order. So it actually depends. I mean, you can say that this looks efficient, but we are not taking into constraints that we have to operate.
Okay.
But I think for the Bangalore people, we know, right? The cross town is how.
I'm not denying the fact.
Fine.
But we also have the constraints that they don't have.
I understand.
Okay, the point is this system had few elements. The amount of structure doesn't really matter. This has many elements, but has a high degree of disorder. This has many elements, but also has a high degree of order. So
actually, the second one, earlier slide you showed discipline, self-discipline is not the best of it. So the previous image requires more of that self-discipline than this structuring order, I believe so.
So there is a very interesting dual that comes up from this. This system has no constraints, but it actually results in not too many liberties. This system has more constraints, but you end up getting more liberties as well. So constraints and liberties are a dual which we seem to miss. So, as the complexity of a system increases, there should be commensurate increase in modularity. So, going back to your question, as you get more information about your requirements, you can keep changing your abstractions if you do not have any information to start with. So, there are two schools of design, or two careers of design, planned design and evolutionary design. We seem to do a okay job on the planned design part, we don't seem to do a good enough job on the evolutionary design part. Refactoring, continuous, opportunist and preparatory is a no-brainer, it has to be. Follow the Boy Scout rule, always leave a quote behind it in a better state in mind. The danger of you going down a rabbit hole, you need to maintain a balance. This is another powerful construct I came across. As your system evolves, how do you keep the modularity increasing? So there are a bunch of transformations. What was nil can be replaced by a constant. What was a constant can be replaced by a variable. What was unconditional can be replaced by an if. What was an if can be replaced by a while. What was monomorphic code can be replaced by polymorphic code, and so on. There are tools available to guide you through your evolution process.
It's okay.
Fine.
It's So is it okay? Thanks, 10 more minutes.
Here's two programs which take a list and compute the sum. One is a top-down, one is a bottom-up. So this can be modeled as a fold left or a fold right. Either case, the result might be the same. So what was a single construct can actually be broken down into two different ways. The duals of logic and control. The logic was summation of the summation function. This was the logic. And the control, we had two implementations, the fold left and the fold right. So what we thought was a single construct is actually two different constructs, logic and control, which can change independently. The concept of declarative programming, workflow engines are underutilized in our industry. Policy mechanisms, domain-specific language. How many of you have come across error messages which are useless? How many of you have written code which doesn't do a good job error handling? So there's a code snippet where given the user information, they do a bunch of validations, update a DB, and send an email to the user. The code in the black handles the happy path. The code in the red handles the unhappy path. This snippet tells you that you can remove all of the red colored code and there will not be any compile time complaints in your code. It is easy for us to overlook error handling. There is no compiler enforcement doing with error handling as well. So given scenarios between the dual of happy path and unhappy path, we seem to not do a good job on the unhappy path. There is a programming paradigm called the recurrent programming, where you think of abstractions in terms of a happy path and unhappy path. There are controlled points between moving from the unhappy path, happy to unhappy, and so on. The Java optional is a good example of this. So going back to your question, we need to alternate between the problem space and the solution space. It's never you dig this completely and then start over here. You don't know whether those problems can actually be solved. If you go too ambitious on the solution architecture front, it may not be relevant to your problem. So doing iteratively is a strong recommendation from this. How do you keep your problem and solution in sync? Test-driven design is a good way. Let me repeat. Test-driven design is not equal to unit testing. Property-based testing is another paradigm. What are these? I want a precise answer. Together, what are they? Human hands. What is this representing? No, together, what are these five things? Hands. So, what was earlier human hands? You said is hands lethal. As the amount of specifics in your code start increasing, the only viable way to manage complexity is to then refactor. Transformations and refactoring are the mechanisms to keep this dual in sync. You can decompose a problem into sub-problems, and these sub-problems can be combined together in different contexts to solve another problem. I believe as a fraternity, we do a good job on decomposition. We don't do a good enough job on composition. There are two approaches, top-down and bottom-up. Top-down will solve the problem for sure, but does it always come up with the best abstractions? Bottom-up gives you the best abstractions, but may not be relevant, may not solve the problem for you. Again, between these two, I don't think we do a good enough job on the bottom-up front. So, on these dimensions, top-down is optimized on the function dimension, while bottom-up is optimized on the form dimension. So like running and rest, what I'm recommending is the notion of alternative refinement and abstractions. I have built a bunch of platforms in my different jobs. Typically, a bunch of engineers, junior engineers, build a system. And I come in and I do the refactoring part. So typically the system takes about 18 months to build and 6 months of refactoring. I hypothesize that if there was alternative top-down happening, the system could have been built in half the time. Going back to the science and math metaphor, I can only claim this, maybe an empirical way of proving this. There is no logical way of deducing this. Unless companies give two alternate teams and do things parallel and so on. So this philosophy of alternating in iterations can be done every few minutes when you write code, every time you get a pull request, or you can do it at a sprint level. In a sprint level, you should have a top-down phase followed by a bottom-up phase. This is how the various duals I mentioned in this tech talk can be kept in sync. Folks, I would like to stop here. Questions, comments?
What does then you mean by yin yang? It is a binary concept or more than that? Like 0 and 1 are other than that?
No. Everything here, synthesis analysis, top down, bottom up, top, bottom, these are yin yang.
Then it always goes 0 and 1. It is two concept, yes and no.
Yes. So,
then it is a design factor, design framework, or what it is?
It is a meta level concept.
Beta level.
Meta level.
Meta.
How long have you been with the current company?
5 years.
Is it 5 years, 0 months, 0 days, 0 hours, 0 minutes, 0 seconds?
No, it can be.
It is what?
I can give an answer with that microsecond,
no.
Nanosecond.
No, you did not. That's because humans are discrete thinkers. We don't think in terms of continuous. Even if you go towards nanosecond, it's an approximation. So humans tend to think in terms of discrete values. And
but machine also cannot take, no, whatever the humans have designed the system, it will take up to that level only. It does not take beyond that.
Okay. The takeaway is that people do top-down but not do bottom-up. People focus on the infrastructure, not enough upon the business. People can go down on the requirements part, but not enough on the architecture part. the gist of this talk is, if you focus on only one, it is suboptimal. You need to focus on the other side. You may have to alternate between them in different cases.
Okay,
that's the
thank you.
So I have one comment actually. What I will have said is true in the context of the industry, but I think one of the main problem of all this is the time. We don't have the time. So, right, for good things. So, how to resolve that kind of issue?
So, this is what I'm saying. If you take, first build an application and then refactor it, it is actually taking more time than had you done the different way. So, okay, as programmers, we have to comply and we have to challenge. I believe we don't do enough of the challenging part. This is a takeaway I want you guys from this talk. Comply when you have to, challenge when you have to.
Yeah, you have to be really careful though. Can be implemented for challenging programs.
I have a slide on that as well.